Hey everybody, Aaron Blaise here, and we've got some new equipment, and I'm hoping it works, but I think everything's working so far. So anyway, it's great to see you, and we're back. It's Thursday, and let's see what's happened since the last time I saw you. I think I talked about my grandbaby, so that's all happening really cool. I've got, let me get rid of this big scribbly image. We don't need that right now. But I've been doing a lot of drawing and painting digitally lately. I've got some work that I'm trying to get done. One of the things I'm trying to do is I'm part of an organization called Expedition Art, and so there's a lot of things that the folks that started the organization are wanting to do as far as helping the environment. Our tagline is, you know, helping the world one drawing at a time. And so one of the things that they've organized that they've asked me to be a part of is this book on 100 endangered species. And so the first image that I've created, one of the animals that I'm doing for the book is the African elephant. And so this is an image right here that that I created over the last few days. And if you saw me over on my Facebook live feed on Tuesday, you saw me start this. And and if I thought maybe I'd be working on it on this live feed, and but I actually had to get it finished because I've got three more animals I need to get done. So it's just the drive that I need to do. So anyway, but what I wanted to show you was there's a lot that goes into, you know, I get a lot of people asking me about the subjects that I draw and paint, but the subject is just such a small part of the actual image a lot of the time. And so obviously the rest of the image, if you're doing representational art, is that environment. And you need to be, you know, you need to put as much thought into that environment as you do the subject. Because it's the environment and subject together that make up the composition, that make up the mood, that make up the spirit of what it is that you're creating. Before I go any further on that, I just want to say I've got my son Dustin Blaise here sitting in the room with me, and he's going to be, just like always, he's going to be asking questions from you guys. Say hi, Dustin.
Hey guys, this time you can hear me.
Yes. And then as usual, I've got my business partner Nick Birch, and he's in Sarasota, Florida. And he's going to be typing up answers and links and all kinds of stuff. So anyway, what I was talking about on, you know, making sure that it's not just subject matter, but it's subject matter and environment, and how those two elements work together in a piece to create, you know, something that's moving and that has some spirit to it. And so, you know, here I have an elephant standing in a savanna. Now, the thought behind this, and I was talking to the folks over on the Facebook live feed, and for some of you this might be repeat if you were there, but the idea behind this is, it's called There's Something in the Air. And because this is a book showcasing 100 endangered species from across the world, I wanted to create things in here that worked literally from a compositional standpoint, and I also wanted to put things in here that were kind of metaphorical. And so a lot of thought went into this. So I've got a lot of grass and everything in here, and that's what we're going to cover today, is my process in creating the grass. But if you look at it from a compositional standpoint, you can see there's almost this flow of how the grass kind of comes up from the bottom and then flows in towards the elephant. I wanted that grass, I purposely did it that way to make sure that the eye is being drawn up and sweeping up into the elephant, into the trunk and into the elephant itself. I wanted to give it this feel as the eye came up and swept around, almost wanted it to feel like wind. And if you look at the way I treated the clouds, they come in from the opposite, so everything is kind of funneling in into the elephant. And then if you look at it, you've got this really strong streak of light. It all kind of converges there and leads the eye to the elephant. Now, from a metaphorical standpoint, and also the elephant itself, from a composition standpoint, I've placed him, you know, over on the left third of the composition. And some people ask me about, you know, how to do composition and what are some of the compositional rules. And in this case, from the subject standpoint, I really just focused on, you know, the classic thirds, where you break your composition into thirds horizontally and vertically, and where those areas cross, you get 4 points on the on the composition that usually feel the most comfortable and dynamic for a subject. And so that's why I placed the elephant up here. Plus, I wanted a lot of open space on the right so that we could feel that sweeping motion. Now, also, the metaphorical stuff that went into it. I wanted to make sure that we felt like it's either a sunrise or a sunset. It's up to you. I wanted to think of it as more of a sunset. He's greeting the sun and he's weathered this storm. And it's the idea of these elephants that are just being slaughtered for their ivory. And the idea that they're weathering the storm, they're making it out. And actually, elephants are doing a little better. And so they've come out of the storm, he survived the storm, and he's facing a new day. And so that's the idea. And you know, and if you're an illustrator, or if you're doing illustrations, then a lot of times it's worth taking that extra time to put those kinds of thoughts into your illustration, because the viewer might not get everything that I've put across, but because I've thought about it in that way, then at least it's going to create a much more dynamic image. And a viewer can at least enjoy that. They might not get the literal or metaphorical meanings that I'm trying to put into the image, but at least they'll feel something and it'll be that much stronger. So it's definitely in your best interest to do that. But there's other things in here too. I mean, I've talked about with folks about getting out into the field and drawing and painting and experiencing the environment and get all over the, you know, hey, it's Jim Jackson's birthday today. Look at that. You see the alert up there? So Jim Jackson, I digress, but I got to say, Jim Jackson and I worked together for years and years and years over at Disney. He's now an animator up at Blue Sky Studios. Look him up on Facebook. He's on Facebook. His name is Jim Jackson. He works at Blue Sky. He and I have a habit of bringing up each other's names in every talk that we do, and it's just so perfect that Jim Jackson's birthday came up. So go find Jim Jackson on Facebook and wish him a happy birthday. He's an amazing animator, and he's an amazing guy. So anyway, so there's Jim Jackson. But anyway, I was talking about getting out into the field and experiencing life and the environment and getting away from the computer and just... You know, you got to soak up. You got to see the world and draw from it in order to create images that feel alive and that feel believable. And so one of the things, I've been in this lighting situation where you've got a low sun, especially here in Florida, where we get these big thunderstorms. And as they pass and the sun is setting, you'll get this light that shines underneath the clouds and there'll be a storm in the background and it's so dark, but then you get this really warm golden light that kind of lights up everything. And what's really neat is if you can get these low shadows, sometimes like you see in this grass here, that shadow will be so low that some of the grass will be tall enough to stick itself up into the sunlight. And I was inspired by that and I've seen it and I wanted to put it in there. And I went through some of my images. And this is an image that I shot of my friend Chuck Williams, who is also our producer on Brother Bear, and he became my co-director on the film called The Legend of Tembo that we were making. And this is a photo I took of him when we were in Africa, and there's that lighting situation. It's not all super tall grass, but there's enough grass sticking up. You know, some, the bases are in shadow, and the tops are sticking up into the light, and so that was something that I thought was really cool. But anyway, I'm going to stop talking about all the peripheral stuff, and I just want to, let's get into what we're going to do today. And so I want to talk to you about creating convincing grass. I have a lot of people that ask me how I do it. They ask me, are you using a special grass brush and all that kind of stuff? And no, the answer is no. I build up these grasses in layers in the same way that I would paint them traditionally. And that's a big thing that I want to say to you now is what I'm going to demonstrate in Photoshop. But as far as other mediums go, this will work exactly the way that I demonstrate it. It'll work exactly the same in acrylic or oil or... acrylic or oil. Because if we get into watercolor is another animal. And you can't, unless you're using a gouache, gouache is an opaque watercolor, and so you can build it up in the same way. So Dustin's got a question. Yeah.
Could you possibly talk about when one should do more detail versus pulling away and letting the scene become less detailed?
Yes, and that's a good question, and I'm going to actually cover that when I'm talking about the grasses today, because here obviously I've got a lot of detail in these grasses, but I'm gonna do some examples of maybe letting some of that detail go away. There's an artist that I based this image on. I've been a fan of this artist ever since I was a little kid. I touched on him a little bit on my Facebook Live on Tuesday, but his name is Wilhelm Kunert. And I think he was alive from like 1840s, somewhere up until about 1925. He was a big game African painter around the turn of the century, and he did these big, beautiful... matter of fact, let me see if I can pull him up really quick. Wilhelm Kunert. I can't remember. Not sure if I spelled it right. Oh, here we go. And let's go right here to the images. So one of the things I loved about, matter of fact, if you look at this image is very similar to my Photoshop image. I wasn't thinking about that image. I wasn't looking at that image, but I had Kunert on the brain, and I've known of his work since I was a kid, and so it really was stuck in there. But you can see the way Kunert handled grasses and foliage, and he was an oil painter. You can see it was much more painterly and much more loose. And that's another style that you can go in. And I'm going to hit some of that today. Oh, actually, here's another good one over here. This one's great. This is one of my favorites. I love the light. Look at that light shining on those elephants. It's big, it's bold, it's impressionistic. But they're beautifully drawn, beautifully painted. And if you look at that grass, it's very, very loose. But one of the great things that he's done is he's picked those highlights. He's picked those darks and he's picked the highlights and place them right where they need to be in order to give the illusion of lots and lots of blades of grass without actually drawing all of it in. And I'm going to hit on that too. So let's jump back to Photoshop. I wanted to show you some of the other images. This is an image I did a while back of a sleeping lioness. And once again, she's sleeping in this big bed of grasses. And once again, it's the same process that I did with the elephant. It's just building it up. And I do grass the same way that I do any image. I think broad. I go from the loose and bold and work towards the detail. Don't start with the detail, all right? Start with the bold, work towards the detail. And the beauty of Photoshop is that we can work in these layers, and so we can go back and forth and do that. And then this is actually an image that I created when I was first learning digital painting. This is back in 2005. But once again, I discovered layers in Photoshop. That was a big deal for me. And so I was able to create, here we go, let me do this. There we go. I was able to create, there. I'm trying to pull them over. There we go. You know, these grasses right here, and you'll see they're a little different only because the brushes I was using back then were different. But the depth and everything that you see in the grass, that's what we're going to hit on today. All right, so I'm being long-winded. So there's all of that. So let's talk about, and the other thing too, sorry. But this will apply to other elements too. Let's say you're drawing big, thick fur on a character, or someone has crazy hair. This approach will also work the same with that as well. So it's not just grass. So think of this. You know, it's really thinking about shapes and then breaking the shapes down to details. That's what we're going to try to do today. So here's a couple of photographs that I took. Let me grab this one. These are scans of photographs. These are photographs I took back in 1998 when I first went to Africa. And these are a couple of young bull elephants that were trying to test each other. And if you look at this grass, this is basically the kind of grass that I had in mind when I was painting the other elephant that, with the rising sun, something in the air. And so you can see right down in here, if I shake my cursor, right down in there, there's lots and lots of detail, but there's ways of fooling the eye. Matte painters are really great at this, where you're suggesting detail without actually painting it all in. Yes, Dustin.
So somebody noticed that you use your own photographs a decent amount. Would you recommend people to do some of their own photography for photo references? Does it help make you notice some details easier?
Yes. So the I firmly believe in using your own photographs. First of all, I don't believe in plagiarizing, and too many people will use someone else's photograph. Let's say it's from Google Images, and they'll use it and they'll use it verbatim. Now, I'll grab a reference from Google Images, whether it be anatomy reference or the shape of leaves or whatever, but I use it as a tool to help me get the illustration that I'm trying to create. I'll never copy that, and very often I won't copy my own photographs either. But one of the biggest reasons why I recommend getting out and shooting your own photographs is it does just that. It gets you out. It gets you out there, it gets you in the environment. Now granted, yes, I live in Florida, and it was hard to get to Africa. It took me a lifetime. You know, I was 30 years old before I ever made it to Africa. But it was a goal, and I wanted to be there. I wanted to breathe it. I wanted to live it. I wanted to experience it, because I used to dream that I was in Africa. I wanted to go so bad when I was a kid, and I wanted to go there and just feel it, absorb it, soak into it, and then bring those experiences home. And when I did, when I went through that process, when I painted my African wildlife that I saw and photographed there, all of a sudden it took on a new life, and it took on a new vitality, because I was able to draw and paint what I had already experienced. And if you're copying it from Google Images, if you're copying it from other photographs, all you're doing is copying a photograph. You're not regurgitating an experience that you had. So as an artist, I think it's important to get those experiences so that you can funnel them, organize them in your brain, and funnel them out of your hands and onto the canvas, okay? So that's my preaching at you today as far as using. Sorry, I've had a cold too, so I might be coughing a little bit. But once again, here's this little guy walking across. But I grabbed this image here because of, once again, the grass. And I really like kind of this area in here. If I shake my cursor again so you can see it. Right in there, there's a clump of grass that I just thought was kind of interesting, and it's kind of mundane. It's just this little clump of grass off to the side that you wouldn't think twice at. But I want to try painting this today. Excuse me, I'm sorry. I'll be coughing all day, but I can't help it. But I'm going to try painting this today, and I want to create a piece of art out of it, create something that's really appealing. So once again, let's just start with this kind of nondescript clump of grass, and I want to, let's paint it. So first thing I want to do, to make things easier, come on, baby. There we go. They're going a little slow. I'm getting a little worried. Let's just crop it. Let's crop it down to what I want to paint, so there's no question. So we have a nice image right there. I'm going to put it off to the side, and I'll pull it over periodically so you guys can see it, so I can show you what I'm doing. And I'm just going to get rid of this one. And let's get rid of the, you know, actually I'll pull them off. I'll pull them off to the side as well. Excuse me, sorry. Oh, I hate those coughs. All right, we'll bring that down. Yes, Dustin.
The writing's a little choppy, but I'll try to interpret it best I can. But how long would the photo that you're just showing, like how long would it take for you to draw that?
Well, let's find out. So as far as what we're going to paint today, we'll probably do it in about an hour. All right. So I've created a canvas right now, a file, and it is 12 by 9.5 inches, only because it's the last size that I just worked with. And I think it's at 200 DPI. Usually I'll do 300, but it might lag because of our streaming. So I went down to 200 DPI. But like I said, usually do 300, that way it'll maintain the detail. I also, excuse me, I like to tone the canvas. And I'm looking at this here, I want to at least tone it somewhat, somewhere in the vicinity of what we're going to work on today. So I'm going to get kind of this warm, it's kind of in the red orange value range, but I want to make it pretty gray, only because I want to be able to see what I'm painting. But it's at least it's going to be in that family, okay? And then we'll just go ahead and we will fill it, okay? So that's the first thing I do. So I'm going to move this over. There we go. And the first thing I always do, even if I'm drawing lots of kind of detail-y stuff like this, I want to at least create some kind of sketch that I think is going to be appealing. So I think I'm going to use this brush. This brush that I'm using, by the way, when we're doing this kind of stuff, you can use any of the Photoshop standard brushes that just come with Photoshop. I'm using my brush just because it's what I've got right now. But you can use any of them, whatever feels good for you. Yeah, Dustin.
How much longer did you spend on the elephant painting after you finished the stream the other day?
Oh, so yeah. So after I saw you guys on Facebook, for those that were there, I worked on it. I think I got back on it about 10:30 at night or so, and I worked on it until about 12:30, and then I went to bed, and then I worked on it the whole day, like another 7 hours. So there was probably about another 8 or 10 hours that I put into it. So it would have been a really long stream. So I'm going to go ahead and draw really quick. So I'm just going to go radio silent for a second. And I'll talk to you about what I'm doing. Here we go. And it looks like, there we go. So anyway, there we go. I'll pull this up.
What was your scariest close encounter with the animals in Africa?
I'm going to hold off on just a second, Dustin.
All right, sorry.
That's all right. One of my scariest close encounters in Africa was we got charged by a big female matriarch elephant. We got too close to the herd and we had to kick it in reverse, but she chased us for quite a ways and I actually got some great photographs. And then the other time was we found a lioness that had just had cubs the night before, and we pulled up and we could see her down in the grass, and I was trying to get a really good photo, and I jumped up on top of the Land Rover, and by doing that I kind of separated myself from the Land Rover, and so as I was standing up and photographing, looking down at her, she was in front of the vehicle, and all of a sudden she just looked at me, and as soon as she realized that I was separate from the vehicle, I could see her eyes dilate, and then she went and she jumped forward. And I can't tell you how scared I was. And I jumped straight up in the air and went right down through the hole in the Land Rover, and we backed out. So that was that. I had to change my shorts on that one. It was scary. But anyway, let me just go ahead and start sketching, because this will take forever if I don't finally start drawing. So the first thing I want to do is at least establish. I want to establish some shapes. And so there's interesting shapes happening in here. I want to establish kind of the clumps, the way they're coming up. And you notice I'm trying, there's a lot of chaos in the grasses, but I'm trying to find some kind of order. And that's a human trait. It's our natural inclination to look at chaos and try to find order. It's why you see, you know, when you see, you know, it's like with faces, you know, when you see some random shapes, all of a sudden, you know, you see a face in it. It's just because we're just wired that way. And so I'm trying to find some interesting shapes in these clumps of grass. And so as I'm working it down, I want the whole thing to have some kind of flow and compositional feel to it. So now I'm going to break away from what I see, and I see, you know, everything's kind of, it's almost like it's a breaking wave. So I want it to flow that way. That's one of the fun things I really like doing with grasses, is it really gives you this ability to guide the eye. And here I'm creating, creating a breaking wave. That can be kind of cool. So you can get the eye to flow in that direction. So first thing I do is just create this loose, very loose, kind of roadmap. And there's going to be, I'll create another layer underneath. There's going to be some more grasses back here in the background, but I'm going to atmospherically push those back, meaning I'm going to put atmospheric perspective. And what that means is, you know, if when you think about the atmosphere, as things get further away, there's more and more atmosphere between you and the subject as they get further and further away. And that the particulate, all the things that are in the atmosphere will tend to take parts that are dark and make them lighter, take parts that are lighter and make them darker, and move them towards the middle, towards a more middle value. So there's less contrast with things that are far than things that are close. And so that's what I'll do back here. I'll push that. Even though it's not that far away, I'll use that atmospheric perspective and get some depth happening. So here, this looks like a bunch of random lines, but what I'm actually seeing here, if I turn this off, is we got some nice flow coming up here, and then grasses coming over, like so. Oh, I just said like so. I'm gonna blow this up. This is the guy, and so here you can see, if I draw over this, what I just did is I'm seeing this shape coming up. Now, once again, I'm using artistic license. I'm creating, even though this looks like a big jumbly mess, you can see there's line work that's happening here. And this comes down in here and all this. And then this sweeps over. And this is where I've decided to kind of bring grasses up this way. So we get this feeling of a wave. Okay, just because that's what I want to do. Sorry, Dustin. So I can take questions now. I just need to concentrate on that, getting that down as I drew.
Do you know about the nature photographer Mattias Klum?
Mattias Klum. It sounds familiar, but I'm not sure.
He's one of the photographers for National Geographic. Mostly photos of venomous snakes.
Oh, I do. No, I'm not familiar with him, actually. So I'll look him up. Mattias? Is it Mattias Klum?
Yeah, Mattias. And his last name is spelled Klum.
I'll definitely look him up.
Are you the only artist in your family?
No. No, I've got... There's several artists in my family and musicians as well. So I come from a family of artists. My father was a musician. My brother... I have a younger brother who is also an animator and amazing artist. His name is Travis Blaise, and he lives up in Seattle. And I've got other brothers that are musicians. I got a sister that's a singer. So it's we have a lot of arts going on in our family. So let me jump. Okay, once again, I'm going to push back on the questions just real quick so I can get the next piece done. So the next bit is I'm going to create a layer underneath. And I want to get, once again, remember, I'm going from the broad, and we're going to work towards the... the detail. So what I want to do is I want to start getting some of that mid-ish tone color in there. So we're getting some warms, one of the other cool things is we're getting reds and oranges working against greens, and so we're getting some complementary colors happening. And I'm going to grab a different brush just so I can cover a little better. This is one of my other custom brushes. But once again, it doesn't matter what brush you're using. So, because I know I'm going to have a lot of people asking me, oh, hey, how can I get that brush? It's not the brush. There's no such thing as a magic brush. It's about, you know, the idea of what we're doing. So notice I'm being very, very broad with what I'm laying in here. The other thing, too, to create... convincing foliage. This is something when we were creating our foliage in our CG films, in our elephant movie, there's a certain amount, even if you're creating a healthy plant, let's say a tree, there's a certain amount of death in that tree that's what we always called it. and it sounds kind of morbid, but what we mean is every healthy tree is still going to have dead leaves and things like that. And when you can get that in there, that's when it makes that leap into realism. And so that's what we're going to have here. We've got a lot of dead grasses, but we have new sprouts coming up, and we've got, you know, all kinds of stuff. Yes, Dustin.
Did your brother work on any animator features that we might know?
Oh yeah, he was a animator of Stitch and Lilo and Stitch. He worked with Alex Cooperschmidt was the supervisor, but he worked very closely with Alex, and he worked on Tarzan. He worked on Hunchback of Notre Dame. He worked on Beauty and the Beast. He worked on The Lion King, I believe. He worked on a lot of different stuff. Yeah, he worked on Curious George after Disney. So notice I'm building up. I'm trying to keep, I'm much more bold right now, but I'm trying to keep in the spirit of kind of the directions of everything. And I'm going to keep this all one layer. So now I'm going to jump over, I'm going to find some greens. I want them to be warm greens. Just for now. So I'm keeping it more, if you look at on my color bar, I'm keeping it towards the warm spectrum. As you move up towards the blue, that green is going to cool off. But right now, I'm just going to keep it. Let me turn that off. I want a nice flat brush. I want everything to be loose in here right now. There we go. Got any more questions, Dustin? Because I can take them now.
What setting can I change in Photoshop so I can brush over a stroke with the same color and not make what's already laid down darker?
The same color. Well, you can try overlay. Overlay might help. What you're talking about sounds like it's set on multiply. But what I recommend doing is come over here. You can either do it up here. There's all the different blend modes up here. And that's for your actual brush or your layer. You can play with your layer over here. Like I can turn this to multiply and you'll see, boom, it gets dark, which I don't want. But there's all kinds of, you know, if I went to overlay, it would get lighter. So just go and I recommend just playing with it, experimenting, see what happens. But I'm going to come in here. I want to just fill this out with some color. And look at the size of my brush. Look at that. I'm keeping it fairly, you know, large and bold. Because we're going to build up the layers. We're going to build this up. But we need a base. We need a base to start with. I'm going to jump back here. And I'm going to create a layer underneath because I want to create a bit of a base back here. There we go. And this is how I did all the grass, whether it's in that lioness or the elephant. Yo, Dustin. Yo.
Would you draw the animal before the grass or after the grass?
I do everything all at the same time. I go back and forth. That way it keeps the composition balanced for me. So I'll jump, you know, I'll work on, like, for the on the elephant, for instance. What did I do with him? Oh, I moved him. On the elephant, for instance, I worked on the drawing like we did here with the grasses, and that's where I put a lot of my time, because I want to make sure that composition is going to work before I put any more work into it. I want to make sure the composition is right. So I work on that drawing and make sure that everything is sitting where I want it to, so it's pleasing to the eye. Then I start working in the values, values meaning light and dark. A lot of times it's monochromatic, meaning one color. There we go. Actually, I'm going to go a little darker. I'm going to go a little cooler now. Let's go cooler with it, because a lot of these greens are going to be in shadow. You know, the thing about the dead grasses are the ones that have already grown and they're kind of reaching the end of their life cycle. The green grasses are the short grasses. See, that's another thing to think about, is thinking about the logic of the life cycle of grass. You know, and you don't really know that unless you get out there and you experience it. So I'm constantly going in. Oops, I'm on the wrong layer. There we go. Constantly going in and painting over, and I'll work this level until I get everything covered. When I come back in, I want to create, let's go a little bit cooler, just a touch cooler, and maybe a little lighter, just to get a little variation in what it is that we're creating. But like up here, there we go. This is going to be fun. I'm going to go a little warmer, redder, because we're getting some nice red tones in here. So look at, you know, it's very abstract, but already you can get a sense of, hey, if this is kind of an expressionistic painting, we've got grass. You know, we haven't even added our any shadows or anything like that yet. Let's just paint that in. Let's just get it in there. There. Well, at this point, I just want to cover up the... Let's go more there. Come up in here. I'm varying up the color. But I'm keeping it... You know, these are all earth tones. It's earth tone, earth greens and ochres and, you know, really paying attention to what my reference is saying. There we go. And then let's go ahead and finish this out. I'm going to go a little cooler.
Any live streamed with traditional media coming up?
Yes. So I get that question a lot, and I really want to get to that. The problem we're having is just the equipment. Once we have the equipment set right, then I will definitely be doing some... I'll be doing traditional animation, animating on paper. We'll be doing some watercolor demonstrations. I'm going to be doing some pen and ink, just drawing demonstrations, you know, all kinds of stuff. So yes, we've got it coming up. We just got to work out our equipment issues. And you notice I'm going a little grayer. You know, if you look here, I'm going just a bit more gray for my grasses in the background because I want to push them back in space. Okay, so here we have something that's roughed in. I'll just hit something on top too. And right now it really doesn't matter what layer I'm working on because I keep just drawing and painting on the wrong layer. So I'm going to hit a couple of these. So now that I've got that established, now we're going to start breaking it down. Okay, so we've got this. Now I'm going to create a layer on top. I'm going to set it to multiply. If you were doing this in traditional media, you would mix up a dark color, make it transparent, and this is where I'm going to start establishing shapes and shadows. So here I want to go cool with it. I'm going to keep it mid-tone-ish. And I'm going to grab my brush that I'm going to use as a... Here we go. As my drawing brush. And I just want to come in now and start establishing some of the shadows and shapes.
What kind of equipment do you need for traditional animation?
What kind of equipment do you need for traditional animation? You need a pencil and you need paper. You know, and you need a disc so that you can put that paper. But when I was a kid, I would do traditional animation in books because all the paper was already bound. So it depends on what you want to do. If you're talking about finished traditional animation, then you know, that's you can film, then yeah, you need to get a disc, an animation disc that's pegged, and you have paper that has pegged holes in it so that they all can sit and they're registered so it doesn't move around. But if you want to just experiment with it, just, you know, get big pads of paper and flip through them. Sticky notes. I've seen people create entire shots, you know, using sticky notes. There's some really interesting stuff out there. And then if you want to shoot it, then you need a good camera that, you know, that's going to be able to do that.
Well, back when you were doing your Disney animation stuff, didn't you have like a light underneath and the paper was like thin enough to where you can see through?
Yeah, some people use the light table. I never use the light table. I don't use it. I think it's a crutch. So I don't usually recommend it, but I know some people do use it. I just personally never did. Because I wanted, you know, one of the things that using a light table did for me was that it prevented me, it made it more difficult for me to actually see the action. I just kept seeing each individual drawing because I was seeing all the way through the paper. But when I turned that light off and I would flip, you know, you can hold five drawings in your hand, and I would flip those drawings, then without that backlight, now I could see each drawing flow into the next drawing, and I could see the movement more easily.
Do you have any hand pains from all the drawing?
Do I have any what? Say that again.
Hand pains, like.
Hand pain? Yeah,
like
I do.
Tunnel or anything like that.
I do. It's just, I'm just dealing with it. I've been doing this for a long time, and I'm going to be 50 next year, so it's just a lot of years of doing it. So here, notice how loose I'm being. I'm still being really, really loose. And I'm just creating randomly some dark areas, but I'm trying to keep with the flow. I used blue because I wanted it to be cool. I wanted the shadows to feel cool. I'm trying to use what I've drawn already. Some of those lines. Like some of this is all kind of, this all kind of goes into shadow in here. So I'm just gonna let that go dark. And then we're gonna build up over it. There's lots and lots of shadow in grass. And it's making sure that you get that well established before, you know, if you're working opaque. Otherwise, you got to establish that those shadows. You got to kind of paint negative space, like in watercolor and that sort of thing. But if you're painting opaquely, for me, it's worth your time to get these shadow shapes, and they can be really random as long as they're fitting the flow of what you're trying to create. It's really important to get them established up front, because then you're going to be painting over the top of them to create depth. I'm going to knock this back right here.
When animating the beast, what did you have to think about, since his anatomy was made up, and how did you determine how he would move and things like that?
Well, the great thing about Glenn Keane, who designed the beast and was the lead animator on that, is that he animated him with logic. Even though there was a lot of different animals that were involved in, you know, the makeup of the beast, there was still a logic to it. And he, you know, once again, doing your homework, we understood the anatomy. We understood real-world anatomy before we went and caricatured the anatomy. So if you understand real-world anatomy, and I don't mean just mean human anatomy, but I mean animal anatomy too, and then the comparative anatomy, how does the scapula and, you know, your upper arm and lower arm and all that, how does that compare to a dog who has the same parts of anatomy just shaped differently? How does that work? Or a buffalo or things like that, the different elements that are part of the beast. And so we used that comparative anatomy knowledge so that we would understand that, oh, even though he looks completely different, this part is really equivalent to this part on us or on a dog or whatever, and so it's going to move like this. And so he was put together in a way that made sense, really. And so it wasn't, moving him wasn't actually that difficult. It was understanding, you know, especially once we understood his personality, then it wasn't difficult. One of the cool things that I love that Glenn did was because he was part animal, but he was also a human, he would try to hold on to his humanity by walking upright. But then when he would regress, when he'd have his tantrums and he would turn into more of an animal, you'd see him drop down to all fours. And so I thought that was a really interesting thing that he did, and I thought it worked well. So we made sure to do that in the film. So here I've got some, it looks like a mess, but here we've got some nice shapes established. So now the fun will begin with just drawing blades of grass. And it's just building it up layer by layer. I'm drawing in negative shapes, negative spaces here. There we go, to get some of these the grasses up on top to kind of come forward. So now I'm going to create a layer on top, and I'm going to go ahead. Actually, I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to pull everything together just a little bit. I'm going to create a layer on top, and I'm going to fill it. I think I'm going to fill it with a slight blue. This is just going to be a test. I want to see what's going to happen. I know it looks weird, but I'm going to knock it back a little bit. I'm going to set it to multiply. Knock it back. Oops, here we go. Knock it back. Now we've got a nice base to start with. Yes, Dustin?
The way you're approaching the grass for this,
yeah.
Is it any different to how you approach drawing bodies of water?
No, actually, that's a very good question. That's a really good question. No, it's no different. When I'm creating bodies of water, I'm thinking about waves, and you want to get down, if you want to get all really detailed and get down to the ripples and things like that, you start broad and you start working those shapes until you get down to where you need to be. So that's a really good question there. So I'm gonna start with kind of a mid-tone-ish. I wanted to bring everything down a little bit so we'd be able to see. Oh, I'm going to kind of create kind of the mid area. I'm going to go a little.
I knew we forgot to do something.
Oh, we got lights. We forgot our lights.
This whole entire time.
I can see.
Plus, is it okay if I turn off the fan?
Yeah, we'll turn off the fan.
Which switch is it?
Right there. The one on the left.
This one.
Yep, there we go. All right, so here. Now, there we go. Now I'm actually going to be drawing grass. And you'll notice, I'm going to make that brush a little smaller. I'm going to stick with the general direction of everything that I'm drawing. But you'll see every once in a while I'll throw in a leaf, a blade that's not quite going the same way. It's really, this is all about how the grass reads over the colors that we've established. It's all about value change.
So do you animate the grass the same way you animate water?
You know what? I've never had to animate grass, and I think if I did, I would go insane. The guys that are able to do that, my hat goes off to them, because all the effects animators I've ever known, they're geniuses, first of all. And I would go crazy. But you can see already, just in this little bit, by establishing these some different values underneath, just by putting a few strokes over the top, like we're doing, and I'm being very, even though I'm being spontaneous, I'm thinking about every stroke that I'm putting down. Yes, Dustin?
Is environment design more complex and difficult to understand than human anatomy and other anatomy?
No, and that's the thing. A lot of people ask me, is this more difficult than this, or is this more complex than this? You know, it's not. Everything has its own complexity. That's the thing. And that's one of the things I love about just the world. I love learning. I'm like I said, I'm almost 50, and I still just love to soak up everything that I can. And what I'm getting at with that is, you know, learning environmental stuff is no different. It's no more difficult. It's just different. It is different. That's the process is the same, and that's what I meant by it's no different. But it's just different. It's just as, you know, there's just as much information understanding human anatomy and all that. You've got to be a student of it all. Here we go. Let's bring all this over. So you can see what I'm purposely doing is I want to start crossing over some of these dark areas, some of these dark negative areas. But I'm also, like that stroke I just put down there, it creates, all of a sudden I'm creating shadows by having those dark areas there. And all of a sudden we're going to start creating depth where we didn't have depth before. And sometimes you'll get a whole cluster of grass that will all just kind of bend over in one direction, which is fine. And then I'll come in and just change it up. Like that. Yes, Dustin.
Have you ever tried your hand at effects animation?
You know, I've done little bits of effects animation in the past for my own little projects. I'm just no good at it. Some of the guys that, you know, the guys that are really good, it just blows my mind. And I'm just not good at it. So first of all, I'm a real impatient guy, and which is funny because animation, I can't wait to get to the end of a shot. and it's one of the reasons I love digital painting so much, is because I love traditional work, but I love digital because I can get in there and create an image that, if I worked in oil, might take me a month, but I can paint it in 2 days or a day or something like that digitally. So here I'm just trying to create, I'm looking at some of the leaves. You know, occasionally, and this is where the eye is going to pick up. The eye isn't really focusing on every single blade of grass in here. The eye is going to focus on the contrasted areas. It's going to focus on the areas that, like these leaves here, that are going in different directions. So you want to be tasteful where you put them. Yes, Dustin.
Is it hard to work on a production with friends? Like, for example, when you directed Brother Bear, does a hierarchy mess a good relationship?
No, because we had a relationship that went beyond that. So I never felt that. And so we all just wanted to make a great movie together. Matter of fact, I felt that it made working together easier. Now, that was my view from my side. If you talk to some of the other guys, maybe they feel different. Who knows? But I felt that I felt that it was easier, and I really enjoyed it. So here I'm coming in. I wanted to have a nice, established, nice darks to work over, and grass shapes, I mean clumps. So I'm trying to work out some of these, like this. Maybe there's a big clump of grass here that's creating the shadow shape underneath. You see there? Same thing over here. We're going to go in with other colors. So I'm not going to get super, super crazy with it. I'm just trying to establish some of the flow. Some of that flow, baby. There we go. You know, some of them have little, you notice I don't noodle, and everybody laughs at my word noodle. That's just something we always say, but noodling is just like picking and picking and picking and working details. I try to stay spontaneous. I love, one of the things I love that to me, painting this grass is very similar to Asian calligraphy, you know, and Japanese calligraphy, Chinese calligraphy. There's such a beauty in the way that's done. And to me, the characters themselves are works of art. And so, to me, trying to create this grass is almost like I'm painting Asian, you know, Japanese or Chinese calligraphy. There's an element to that. It's a spontaneous and be done with it, move on. Yes, Dustin?
How come you don't use your foliage brushes?
Well, you can, but for me, the foliage brushes... that's something if you want to get it done quickly, and for me, I don't want to use the word cheat. I'm trying very hard to not use the word cheat, but I meant for the foliage brushes to be that, to be something where you could create an environment quickly and be done with it and move on. Whereas here, I'm trying to show you how to paint it if you didn't have those, how you would paint it traditionally or how you would paint it with just regular brushes digitally. Now, we could sit down and we could have this done with my foliage brushes in about 5 minutes, but it wouldn't quite be the same. It wouldn't quite be the same. So here I'm trying to get this to kind of curl over. I want to go a little.
Texted asking if you could zoom in the portrait.
The image?
Yeah, the image.
There we go. How's that? Because that's full screen now, baby.
Well, about to see it.
Oh, it hasn't come up yet. There we go.
Yeah. You know, there's that delay going on.
All right. So here, I just changed the color just a bit. I wanted to get a little bit, some warmer color in. So I'm just going to hit it in different places. I got to pull back on it. But you can see we're starting to get some shape now. So this is going to be kind of the dominant grass color. But we're also going to go in with some cools. We're going to go in with some greens because we want to get that new life. Remember I was talking about that new life to get it to read a little better and feel a little more believable. There we go. So I think we've got enough. Actually, I want to hit this in here too. There we go. We're going to go in here with some other colors. Went a little warmer with some of the grasses in here. There we go.
Do you feel to be successful you need a college degree? Or have you known people to be successful without a degree?
I don't have a college degree. I went to college, but I never got my degree. So if that means anything, I do believe some people need to go to college, and I believe some people can get along without going to college. Now I'm talking strictly art in the art industry, because it doesn't matter. No one cares about, to be honest, to be bluntly honest, in the industry that I've worked in. And it might change for other people, and I don't really want this to be an excuse for someone to go back to their parents and say, "See, I don't listen to Aaron. I don't need to go to college." That's not what I'm saying. But at the end of the day, you know, an employer is not going to be looking to see if you have a degree to whether or not they're going to hire you. They want to see if you can do the job. Now, sometimes that takes going to college. Some people learn better in a more structured college atmosphere, and other people can be. Are better self-motivated. So it really depends on, I'm going to create a layer underneath and hit some of these grasses in the background. So it really depends on, you know, what your level of drive is, I guess. But there's so much on YouTube. There's so much on, you know, my channel's on YouTube, and we're constantly, you know, trying to put new stuff out there. So there's stuff everywhere. You know, we truly live in an age of information. And so if you want it, it's there, obviously.
What is the canvas size of the...
The canvas size is 12 inches by 9.5 inches at 200 DPI. I usually go 300 DPI, but I was afraid that it might lag because of our broadcast. So I'm just throwing in some random grasses in the background just to break up.
How do you come up with ideas for new drawings when you don't know what to draw?
I don't have that problem a lot. A lot of times I'll know what I want to do, but if that comes along, I just start drawing. And I know it sounds weird, but no, just randomly draw. And something will pop into your head. I'm going to get a little looser back there, a little loosey-goosey. So let's go to the next level. So I want to get some of these greens in here. Okay. I'm going to go a little cooler. Bring it down in here. Down in here. There we go, right down in this area. And once again, I'm going to be finding places over the darks to start breaking up these darks. And some of these brush strokes will get kind of short, because the green grass is not tall. And you'll notice I'll just kind of get little flicks in there sometimes, because eventually that'll feel like we're looking through negative space. And now I'm starting to think about, okay, what's this? Where is this grass growing out of? Maybe it's coming out of this negative space right in here. And now I'm also going to look at places that I've already established as green. And notice I'm drawing underneath this layer. I'm going to go back and forth. I'm drawing on the background layer. And I actually didn't forget that time. Because I want to... This is the beauty of Photoshop, is that we can go in and we can start out on one layer and then we can move to another. There we go. And I want some nice greens up in here.
Say, are there any other channels that you would recommend for somebody to go and check out if they're interested in like any other styles of art or anything like that?
You know what? I truly am not trying to just hoard everybody to me. I don't know. I truly don't. I know there's other, I can see them. I just can't remember their names. Nick, I know Nick knows some, and Nick can throw some up on the, he can maybe put some links up there. But notice how some of these green grasses now, it's starting to fill in some of these gaps. And I'm going to start breaking like the direction too. There we go. And I'm getting to some of these dark negative spaces. And now we can start playing with temperature too. I want to get more yellow green. Let's go on top now. I'm trying to be bold. You know, be bold with that color. You know, but if you're with the grass that, like this, where the bulk of it is dead grass, then you want to be tasteful with that pure color that you're putting in. Notice how I'm putting in, you know, small flecks here and there. That's kind of that was the thought behind that lioness. The other thing too is to break some of that direction a little bit. Because the grass doesn't all grow in the same direction, see? Maybe some of that, the green that we established is picking up a little light. That earlier cooler green. And so now it's, you know, we can get some warmer color in there.
Bobby Chu, I think, is...
Bobby Chu, yes, Bobby Chu. I don't... So he's schoolism. I'm not sure if that's... if you have to pay or if he has a YouTube channel, but I highly, highly... If there's content out there, whether you're paying for it or it's free, look up Bobby Chu, because the guy's amazing. And he gets some incredible artists. I know a lot of the artists that he... that he's working with, and they're all top notch, and I recommend all of them. So I'm jumping back over now to some other. I want to start breaking this up just a little bit more, but you can see already now we're starting to get some nice things happening there. Eventually I'm gonna have to really do a lot of work in the background. But not yet. Alright, so now I'm gonna go underneath. Watch what I'm gonna do now. I'm gonna go underneath. I'm gonna grab my darkest dark, and I'm gonna go even darker. Almost black. I think I want to make that more in a blue, even cooler. And it's going to look really kind of strange, but I'm going to come in now and I'm going to establish some really deep darks, and I'm going to paint them in a way that I'm creating negative spaces. And all of a sudden, you're going to start seeing depth. It's going to look weird, but we're going to go in and we're going to fill it in even more. But this is, you know, we're not using any kind of fancy grass brush. We're just drawing and we're thinking about value and color. And we're letting the eye break up what we're establishing. There, we're getting some nice depth in there. I think we're going to get, I'm going to go dark in there.
Do you use other software other than Photoshop?
Yeah, I occasionally use Painter. I like Painter a lot. It's just I've done so much work with Photoshop. I just like it a lot, and so it's comfortable. I should say, I put it that way. For me, it's very comfortable. Come down in here.
Somebody's asking if you always start drawing the grass in the foreground and work your way to the horizon. If so, what's the thought process behind that approach?
I don't always do that. Matter of fact, I'll go back and forth. If I'm in Photoshop, I do like to keep, if it's a big expanse, then I'll try to break up the distance into three different planes. I'll have a foreground, midground, and background, and I'll break those up into different layers. But other than that, I'll actually go back and forth. Now, that's hard to do because obviously you want to make sure that you're not painting your extreme far grass over the top of your close-up grass. So you got to make sure you're in the right, on the right levels and all that kind of stuff, which I'm terrible at. But notice here, so there's a nice big dark, you know, this, I want this to have some kind of interest rate in here. So let's establish like a little mouse house. Let's put a little mouse house in there. We'll go nice and dark. But I'm trying to create, I'm sorry, Dustin, I'm trying to create just a few little negative shapes in here to establish that maybe there's some grass or something inside there like that. Yeah, go ahead, Dustin, sorry.
What was your first break in your animation career?
My first break in my animation career was I was promoted to animator while we were making a film called, it was a short cartoon called Roller Coaster Rabbit. It was a Roger Rabbit cartoon. And so getting promoted was a big break for me. One of the guys in the studio had left, and it left an opening, and so several of us did some animation tests to try to fill the spot, and I was lucky enough to be chosen. And then, but then the big break for me, the first feature I worked on was, I did a few minor scenes here and there in The Rescuers Down Under. And then, and I was just still kind of learning, you know, kind of cutting my chops on it. And then my big break for me was when Glenn Keane was doing The Beast and Beauty and the Beast, and he asked me to be one of the animators to work with him. And the great thing about Glenn Keane is how generous he is in the work that he hands out. He hands out really juicy scenes. And because of that, he handed me some great scenes that allowed me to shine, and that allowed me to get bigger and bigger roles down the road on different films. And so that was the biggest break, and I really owe Glenn a lot of thanks to that, because he helped really make my career by giving, you know, having the faith in me to create those shots. So now you can see real quick, Dustin, before I wanted to, you know, you can see that I've created all these kind of really dark negative spaces. Now we're going to start building up over the top of them again. Go ahead.
Do you think virtual reality is going to change the industry?
I think virtual reality is going to change everything. I think virtual reality is going to change our entire lives. If you think about where we'll be in 20 years or 15 years with virtual reality, it's not going to be just the entertainment industry, video games, film, whatever. It's going to change how we do everything. It's going to change how you go on vacation, you know? And yes, I think it's a virtual reality is a big deal for us. So what I've done here is I've just created these negative spaces, these very dark negative spaces. And now I've created a layer on top. Now, keep in mind, if this layer is just over the dark negative spaces, then this layer is kind of the deepest layer of grass. So what I want to do is I want to kind of go very cool in the green, and I'm going to go not too light. I'm going to go kind of gray. Hold on, Dustin. I'm going to go just a little bit more gray. There we go. Yes, Dustin.
Sorry about that.
That's all right.
Any chance you can zoom back in?
Yes. There we go. So now what I'm going to do is I'm working underneath all these layers with these cool colors. I'm going to just bring the size up just a little bit. And now I can break up some of those. There we go. They're kind of all in shadow. I'm going to go a little lighter with it. There we go. So you can see, this is where, the idea of using cool and warm. These cool colors will sit underneath and recede into the darkness. And also, I want to make sure the value is right, the light and dark. There we go. So we're getting a nice base happening. All starting with that real rough drawing, thinking about the shape. So there, like here, I've got color already that's basically the same value. So I'm going to go a little lighter with it. Now I can come in and... There we go. We've got stuff established in here. What's happening, Dustin?
I think it was somebody new in the chat said, "Who is Dustin?" And a lot of people just started writing it. Dustin's his son. And somebody... further down the road, Dustin is our gatekeeper. I am the gatekeeper, Ray.
There we go. So you can see how some of these cool colors kind of recede. They sit down inside the grass. We're getting some depth in there. I'm going to get some of this in here. And I can get really kind of squiggly with it in here, too. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
What courses can we expect to see this year on your website?
Well, I've got the bear course coming. I kept getting sidetracked doing this, that, and everything else, but the bear course is coming, I promise you. And then how to draw bears. And then I'm going to do a full course on how to draw elephants. Right now I've got the PDF, but I'm going to do a big video on how to draw elephants. I got to do that because that's just, I love elephants so much. But I'm also going to be doing... I'm going to be doing a course, more traditional media, watercolor. I'm going to be doing a full course on digital painting. So we're focusing on both Photoshop and Painter. And it's going to be, my approach, because there's a million different ways you can paint digitally. So it'll be my approach. And then we're going to be bringing in some other artists this year as well. People that I respect, that I've been in the industry with for a long time, that I feel have something to say beyond what I can say. And so I'm going to ask a few people to, to create some courses for us, and we're going to get those out, later in the year. So here I'm trying to create a little bit of little squiggly grasses down in here in our little mouse house. There we go. So I'm just getting really kind of random now. I'm just going through. I wish you could see me, because I'm not just the cursor. Let me blow this up a little bit. But I'm just going through very randomly. There we go. Now, this is where the fun begins. We've got this all established, and I've really been neglecting the far background, but we'll get into it in a little bit. But now we've got all this established. Now we can go in very tastefully. We're going to go on the top, and from a value standpoint, I want to start hitting some brighter values. And now this is where you want to be careful. You want to be tasteful and just hit certain areas. This is where the whole thing is going to start to sing.
What is your favorite cartoon?
My favorite cartoon. Now, if you're talking about features, I don't really have I love the old classics. I love Pinocchio and Bambi. I love Iron Giant from a storytelling standpoint. There's a lot of stuff that I love that out there. Classic, like regular old cartoons, classic cartoons. My absolute favorite and will always be my favorite are all the Warner Brothers, Donald Duck, or Donald Duck, Daffy and Bugs Bunny and the Roadrunner. I spent my youth watching all that stuff. And I just loved it. So now you can see these light pieces of grass. These are the ones that the eye is going to see. And now you can see all of a sudden it starts to give it life from a compositional standpoint. It starts to get life. So I just want to hit it very tastefully in the right places. And actually, in little clumps, some areas will get more. Like so.
Nick wanted me to mention that we'll be doing a snow bear course on the entire pipeline and process.
Yes, that's one of our biggest ones. Now, hopefully that'll be this year, but, the snow bear project is huge. But we're doing, our animated short, Snow Bear, and not only is it going to be, it's not just going to be an animated short, we're going to turn it into an entire course. So we're recording the entire process, and I'm going to explain the storyboarding, I'm going to explain the character design, the animation. It's going to be a complete course on how to create your own animated short. That's going to be a huge amount of work, but that's definitely, it's something that we want to do, and it's on the books. So you can see, just by hitting these accented bits of grass, I'm going to have some of them cross over here. And I'm deliberately trying to hit some of these to go over my dark areas, so you get some depth in there.
Did you do much or any animating on Brother Bear, or did you just direct who animated the parts?
I actually, when I had all, once I had all my meetings done and I had all the approvals done or whatever, I would actually do some animation. I would sit in my office, and I wasn't doing a lot because I was getting called into one meeting or another, but I did, the whole section where he first turns into a bear. With Tanana, not the stuff where he's screaming. That's all the brilliant animation of Byron Howard. But there's stuff in there where he's after she's left, where she says, he has to go to the mountain or the lights touch the sky, or the mountain, the earth touched the sky, and he's not knowing where she went. There's some animation in there that I had done, and the chipmunks are talking, and he's looking back and forth, and he says, "You just talked." It's all that kind of stuff. I animated that. So it was just like little shots here and there to help out with the animation crew to help hit quota. So, and it was, plus I wanted to animate on it. And notice too, I'm hitting little areas in here to create little areas of interest. So like these leaves, I hit, like there's a clump of plants that have these leaves attached. And maybe I go in a different direction than here. And some of these strokes are short. You know, some of it's catching light and then it might go into shadow and then it comes out and catches light again. So, but you can see how these accents really, this is where it gets fun. It starts to really sing and you can really play with it and get it to work. There we go. And it's really important to hit random bits of grass that don't kind of follow everybody else. And I want to match, I want to see if this is all, I'm going to have this kind of, all this kind of get into light. So I'm going to go a little bit heavier in here.
Is the Art Story Project still going?
The Art Story Project is still there. It's still in development. I've just had an incredibly difficult time getting anybody to pick it up. We, I've pitched it to every major studio, Warner Brothers, Blue Sky, Sony, Fox, and everybody, they had their slates already full, and they just weren't interested. So it's, we got to figure out what to do with it. And I still have a lot of faith in it. It's a very emotional story. It's not just this big adventure through paintings, but there's a lot of emotion in it. And I feel it's a story worth telling. And so we just got to figure out how to get it out there.
Did you ever meet one of the nine old men?
I've met several of the nine old men. I met, trying to think, Ward Kimball and Ollie Johnson, Frank Thomas. I met a lot of them. Harris, trying to think. There's a few in there, few more. I just can't remember. let me get that. There we go.
If you could live anywhere in the world, where would you live?
I'm living in right here. You know, I love where I'm at, wherever I'm. I know it's like a canned, corny answer, but you know, I used to really long to be someplace that I wasn't. And my wife taught me a great lesson before she passed away. It was, you know, she said it. She said, Aaron, you're never happy with where you're at. You know, and there's a truth in that. And there's, you know, to be, and I don't mean satisfied. I don't mean to be dissatisfied with where we're at, but just be content. And so wherever I'm at, maybe I'm striving to go someplace else, or I might strive to go wherever, but I've lived my life long enough now that, you know what, I don't know what's around the corner. I don't know where I'm going to be in 5 years. I don't know where I'm going to be in a month. My life has changed so drastically in the past so many times that the big lesson is just breathe and be happy with where you're at. Because you know what? It's going to change. Life will throw you curveballs. People will come into your life. People will exit your life. And as long as you can be happy and enjoy the people that are there and the places that you're at, and then you're going to be all right. And so I've, you know, when my wife expressed that to me, it really hit home. And then ironically enough, 2 years later, she passed away. My life changed completely. So she taught me a big lesson. There we go. So we got all of our accents happening here. And now look at the depth we're getting. See how cool that is? Just by building it up, thinking about value, thinking about color temperature, all that kind of stuff.
You can zoom it in real quick so they can.
Yep, sorry, I keep doing that. That's my comfort zone. So let's go ahead and try, let's hit some of these areas in the back. Back here. Actually, yeah, I think that's okay. I'm going to go a little darker. I just want to just hit some of these. Just very lightly, because basically everything that I've shown you in the foreground grass is exactly what we do in the background. I'm working around some of those dark values, you see? There we go. Oh, there we go. Ah. Very quick. Notice how it's quick. You don't want to noodle. That's the word of the day. No noodling. No noodling. And some of these, I'm gonna keep the value down so that the values of the foreground grass will still pop.
What does it mean to noodle when you say no noodling?
No noodling. Don't do this. That's what I mean by noodling. No noodling. You just keep working it and working it and working it. You know, and it's just, it doesn't make it better. It just makes it messy. So some of these patterns got a little too repetitious. But I'm going to come in here now. I want to go a little, I'm actually going to go a little brighter. Because there's some really bright, if you look on here, and I'm kind of making it my own. But if you look in here, there's some really bright, bright areas. So now, I'm going to throw another layer on top. Go even brighter. Keeping it warm. Keeping it warm. Now, once again, for the amount that we did on the next value, the next bright value behind this, the one we just finished, you want to go even less with this one, except for this area that I'm painting right now.
Are you just choosing a smaller brush size now that you're working on the background, or is it just a lighter touch of the stylus?
It's a lighter touch of the stylus, and I'm not changing the brush size at all. This is the same brush size I've been using since we started painting the grass. But I'll go light with it, I'll go hard with it. The whole key here is to create variety. Now I want to balance this. I've got a lot of really light value up here. I'm going to continue down. There we go. So now I've got that popping from that background. Now I got to balance it, okay? Now that's going to be the place that has the most, but maybe I hit over in the background back here. There's a few. That come up and create. Notice I'm going in different directions. I'm being really spontaneous. Some are brand new blades that I'm painting in with the white, and then other ones I'm just highlighting blades that I've already drawn in. There we go. And it's these little flecks of light color, you know, these. You know, look how I'm doing this. I'm doing like these little flecks. That's what the grass will do. It just picks up little bits here and there, and that's where your eye is going to be drawn to. Notice all of the other colors that we established earlier are getting pushed deeper and deeper into the grass. Just takes time and patience and control. You want to stay in control of it all the time.
What is your favorite type of grass to paint?
You know what? I just like painting foliage. This kind of grass, I like to do it because I can be, like I said, it's like calligraphy. I don't have to worry about the drawing specifically of the leaf shapes. I can get in there and just bang, 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 you know, and just, it's kind of, it's fun. And so that part of it, this grass probably is my favorite because it's just, I like building up just through line work, really. We're just creating lines, but all of a sudden we're creating mass and depth and light.
When was the last time you played a computer game?
Ask my son. Never.
Well, for you,
I think
I used to... you had something like way back in like in the early 90s. Like it was like a very classic sim.
Well, there's a flight sim that I did, but I've never been a gamer. You know, we went through a phase where we were doing Bond. We were playing Bond.
Yeah, that was on the Nintendo 64.
That was at the studio, and a whole bunch of us were playing that. I'm going to go a little darker.
Yeah, for me personally, I haven't played... I have my own gaming computer, but it's in storage right now. Ever since I moved down here from Canada, that was about, what, 5 months ago?
Canada,
eh? From the Great White North.
But yeah,
I miss my computer games.
So, we're getting pretty close. So now look at the grass we've got. And it doesn't feel out of control. It doesn't feel, I've tried very hard to make sure that the flow remains. There we go. I'm just trying to get some spontaneous pieces in here. There we go. Put up some lighter ones in the background. There we go. I'm going to jump underneath a couple of these layers. Maybe on top of this layer. Let's go a little warmer.
What was your favorite part of working on Brother Bear?
Well, one of the great parts of working on Brother Bear as a director is that I'm involved. See, I'm going to get some nice warm color in there. You see that? I'm involved in every aspect of the film. So I'm involved in the writing. I'm involved in the music, which was, because I love to play music. I play guitar as well. And so working with the composer... And working with our songwriter, it was Phil Collins, and so that aspect of it, going in and recording, was fantastic. That was probably other than story was the most difficult. But beyond that, I think doing the music it's great because you can see the film really come together, especially when you're doing the score.
Would you consider games to be an art?
Oh, of course. Games are a form of storytelling, art. Absolutely.
I always thought of it as somewhat like an interactive movie.
Yeah.
In a way.
Yeah, man.
And somebody else asked, can we please see Dustin?
Come on over here, Dustin. Poke your head in here.
Oh, boy.
This is my Sasquatch of a son.
Hi, everybody.
There he is.
How's it going, everybody?
There he is.
That's me.
All right, we're almost done here. I'm just adding a few flecks of kind of yellow-green underneath. I think we're going to go underneath. Actually, no, I'm going to put that back up on top. Because if it's yellow, I want it to be catching some light. So the logic of it is, it should be more towards the surface. Always think about the logic. The logic. There we go. I want it sitting on top of some of those warm greens we put in there. But there we go. I don't have to finish out the back, I don't think. Matter of fact, let's do this. Meow. That would chop it. There. I just cheated. So now, let me go back here. I'm going to pick up a few more yellows. There we go. It's all about control. Keep that, think about the logic. Think about how the plants are growing. The green, the life is the new shoots, and it tends to be the shorter grass. And so the tall grass is the stuff, the ground grass is the stuff that's, you know, at least in this life, in at this certain point of the life cycle of the grass, that's what's happening. You know, there's points where all the grass is green and it's all growing tall, but at this point, I'm just hitting a couple more. I want to finish out that feel. So how long did it take us? We got an hour and a half into this? And that's with, you know, a lot of me yakking.
We started at 1, it's 2:36 right now.
Yeah, so, you know, an hour and a half. If you're working this, you should be able to do this in an hour and a half. But think about the logic. Think about the layers, building it up. And really, before you start to draw, really understand what it is that you're drawing. Understand that grass. Understand the drawing of it. You know, all of that. But there we go. There's our grass. And it's done loosely. But this is the same way. Let me pull this. And actually, when you shrink it up, now you can start to see it come together. That's why I like to work like this, because I can see the shapes a little bit better. It's like stepping back from a painting, you know? And I'm going to get a couple of random tall pieces up in here just to break up the background a bit.
Don't forget to zoom back in every once in a while so people can see better.
Oh, yeah, I will. Right now, I'm purposely working small so I can see. There we go. So there it is. And that was all done with that. And if you really hung up and you want to get this brush, you can actually, if you go to my website, creatureartteacher.com, and if you sign up for the newsletter, you'll get this. I keep holding up the stylus. You won't get a stylus. You're not going to get that. But you'll get the Photoshop brush that I used on this painting. You'll get that for free. We'll send it to you in the mail. So let me pull this over. Beep. Let me pull that over, knock that back a little bit. And let's just review, let's look at some of these other grasses. So now, when you look at this, you can say, oh, okay, that makes sense. Now I understand how we did it. It's just different colors. And I chose to put some different stalks of grass in there, but you can see it's really the same thing. I built that up the same way. Now, I'm going to do something here in a second, but I'm going to jump back one more. Where is he? There he is. And then here's my bull elephant. And if I blow this up, so once again, same thing with these grasses, just a different color scheme, okay? You can see all that. All the values are closer together, but it's the same idea, okay? So we can do another thing. I'm gonna hold you guys a little longer. Let's have some fun. I'm gonna experiment a little bit. I wanna see what happens if, let's try something. Yeah. This is thinking after the fact. So it might not work. Because normally if I'm gonna have light and shadow, I like to plan for that, but I just wanna see what's gonna happen. I'm gonna create a layer on top. I'm gonna set it to multiply. And let's say there's a shadow going across our grass. Let's create some light and shadow now. Maybe that shadow, I'll blow it up a little bit. Maybe this is all in shadow. See how cool, just by setting something to multiply, you can get it to feel like it's going into shadow? I don't like it. I like the shadow. I just don't like that. We've got the sweeping going up this way, so I might counter it by bringing the shadow. Oh, let me set it to multiply. There we go. I might counter it by bringing the shadow in this way.
Do you work up your painting from grayscale?
No, I don't. Not usually. Sometimes I do. I've been known to do it, but actually I want that shadow to come up. There we go. So you notice the shadow can also define the shapes of the grass. Maybe this all kind of goes into shadow.
Can you draw a moose? I just had to ask that question.
I can draw a moose, but not right now. We're going to focus on grass, man. Not that kind of grass, this grass. So look at that. So already we got something that's kind of, that works pretty cool. We got some nice light and shadow by setting it to multiply. And now I want to try something else. Let's go to overlay. Let's grab some nice warm orange color. So we used a blue. We used a blue color for our overlay, for multiply. Now I'm going to come in here and I'm going to overlay and I'm going to warm up. Look at this. I set it to overlay. Look at the fun you can have. I'm just going to overlap that shadow a little bit. So, oh man, I love it. Look how warm that gets. Oh man, this is looking good. Look at that. Now, all of a sudden, this thing is just taking on a life of its own. Look at that. Go up here a little bit. Yeah, Dustin.
If you could direct another movie, what would you like it to be?
Oh, man, I want to do another animal film. You know, I was directing a film called The Legend of Tembo a while back, and I really loved that film. I loved the story. And if I had the ability to do it again, not that I'm living in the past, don't get me wrong, I would love to do that. So I love that story. And I, you know, magical creatures like elves and fairies and things like that, I've always had a fondness for that. But just real quick, so look at, just by creating a multiply layer over this and creating a shadow and then going in with our overlay with warm, look how we've got this amazing, really great sense of light. This is what I love about, you know, some of the fun you can have with Photoshop. Because what I like to do, if I'm working traditionally, is I love to sit down and work up something like this in Photoshop because it's so quick and easy. And then I can output this and use this as reference for doing a traditional painting. Let's try, I'm gonna try a couple more things. Now that I got this established, let's go in and really play with our blues. Now, you know, we've got cool and we got warm. So let's play with our kind of blue violet in the shadow area and kind of push some of that. And then let's go really warm and hot in the light areas and see what that does. Yes, Dustin.
Will you be able to make a tutorial on ambient occlusion?
Oh yeah, I can do that. Yep. So we'll do something like that down the road.
Is there anything you can't draw?
There's things I won't draw. But look how blue this is. But when I get it in the right environment, look how it pulls together and kind of goes gray. But it's still nice and cool. And this is actually something that we're going to be covering. One of my great friends, Ronnie Williford, who is one of the best painters I know, and really knows color really well. We've asked him to create a course on color and color theory. And there we go. So now we've got these really neat, I might have gone a little overboard on that. I'm going to knock that back just a touch. There we go. And so he's going to be doing that for us because I think it's something that's really needed. I'm going to go like just super pure yellow. Let's just see what happens. Whoops, on top. Let's just go really super pure yellow in some of our orange areas. Just little flecks. That's all I need. I mean, look how pure that is. I mean, it's super yellow, but used, if you use it tastefully in the right areas, then now you're creating light. That's what I'm trying to create here. I'm trying to create light. Yes, Dustin?
Someone's asked, I got two questions. One is, are you able to draw vehicles? And another one is, will you do like a drawing of the future of a moose?
Yes. Someone's hung up on the moose.
Oh, there's a lot of people asking about mooses now.
I will draw a moose at some point, not on this one. But I'm terrible at drawing vehicles. I don't know why. I've never been much of a motorhead. I don't know if that's part of it, or made up vehicles. I'm just, I went through a phase where I really loved drawing, you know, space vehicles and things like that when I was younger. But no, it's for me, my favorite stuff to do is all natural environment type stuff. So I'm finishing up this up very quickly. I'm going to hit this one more time with some very bright color. Maybe some of this is really getting hot. See there? And I'm going to hit some hot areas in here. And I'm going to hit a couple hot areas in here. Actually, I'm going to create, I'll put that on another level just in case I don't like it. I can. I'll push that back just a little bit. So there we go. So look at that. So now all of a sudden, you know, adding that shadow and light, we've got something that really feels cool. And we just created a piece of art from this one little mundane thing. Let's do, oh, I'm going to do one more thing. I'm going to save this. Save as grass, man. Let's save it there. Now, just real quick, I'm going to go ahead and flatten it. And remember those dark areas that we put in? Look how they've survived. And now all of a sudden those dark areas that we painted earlier, look at that. It's like you're looking inside the grass. You know, places like in here and right in there, down in there. Now it's becoming positive and negative space. That's so cool. And as we've gotten further back here, I just kind of let that go and I didn't go, you know, as dark. And so it recedes into the distance back there. But I want to try one more thing. Let's, what am I doing? Here we go. Let's flatten the image real quick. And I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to save it as grass flat. I like to keep separate files like that. But what I want to do is I'm going to try grabbing a nice, warm, bright color. I just want to see what it's going to look like. And then I'm going to come up here. I'm going to grab my airbrush. Just a regular standard Photoshop airbrush. Turn that off. I'm going to knock the opacity down to 8%. And I'm going to color dodge. Now, let's see what happens. I'm going to knock that brush up right in some of these areas. Oh, yeah. See how hot that gets? And right in there.
Man, everybody's caught up on the moose thing now.
What is it with the moose?
Moose driving a car.
All right, so there we go. So that's it, folks. There's the grass. That was fun. I really enjoyed it. I'm going to draw a moose next week. I'm tired. I've been drawing for an hour and 49 minutes. But I really enjoyed this. I hope you guys had fun. I hope you learned something. I really enjoyed creating this. And and the thing is, you never know what you're going to come up with. I mean, that's what we started with. It was, you know, I looked at that and said, okay, this is what we want to do. And this is where we ended up. So it's something, it's completely different, but it's, you know, it's a piece of art on its own. So go out and try it. And like I said, you can, this kind of thinking can be done with acrylic painting, oil painting, you know, whatever. So try it, go out, have some fun, and remember, put some beauty back in the world because we need it. Everybody needs it. So until next week, I will talk to you later. Oh, remember, Facebook on Tuesday. You want to come over and see me live over there. and check out my website, creatureartteacher.com. And thank you. That was fun. Bye. I'll talk to you later. Bye.